Good morning, everyone. Today we'll discuss about the meningitis. It's the infection of the meninges. I'm Dr. Bhupendra Saha, assistant professor at Department of Internal Medicine, BP Koirala Institute of Health Sciences, Dharan, Nepal. So why we need to know about this condition, meningitis? It is the one of the medical emergency. If you do not diagnose a patient with meningitis in proper time and do not give them the proper antibiotics, then the prognosis of the meningitis is so bad. That's why it's one of the medical emergency state, and the every medical practitioner should know about the meningitis. It is not uncommon. It is one of the highly prevalent condition. Annually at BPKHS, we see more than 200 cases of meningitis. And why, as a medical student, you need to know? Because you people are the frontliners, and when you pass your MBBS and you work as a intern and then the medical officer, you have to recognize meningitis in the first place so that we can give them the antibiotics in the appropriate time. So what are the objectives of today's session? In today's session, we'll discuss about the definition of the meningitis, then about the encephalitis, then about the brain abscess. We'll discuss about the etiological agent of meningitis, then its pathogenesis, clinical feature, investigation, and how we are supposed to manage the patient with meningitis. Okay. So be attentive to the class and watch till the end of the session. It will be productive for you all people. So definition-wise, what is meningitis? In our brain, especially the brain parenchyma, is covered by the three layers. First, second, and three. There are three layers in the brain parenchyma, which is covering the brain parenchyma. The famous acronym for that covering is PAD, P-A-D, PAD. That is biomatter, arachnoid matter, and the dura matter. So in between these spaces, there are some potential spaces. Like in between the biomatter and the arachnoid matter, it's the subarachnoid space. And in between the arachnoid and the subdural, in the dura matter, there is a subdural space. And the meningitis is the inflammation or infection. Basically, inflammation of the subarachnoid space and adjacent leptomeninges, that is subarachnoid matter and the biomatter. So if there is a inflammation established at the level of the subarachnoid space, then that is what we call the meningitis. In meningoencephalitis, beside the meningitis, there's also the inflammation of the encephalon, that is the brain parenchyma. If there is inflammation of the brain parenchyma too, then that we call the meningoencephalitis. In a brain abscess, the brain abscess is the area in the brain parenchyma where there are the inflammatory cells and which is surrounded by the definite capsule. That's brain abscess. Okay. So what are the common bacterial organisms that we get when we are managing a patient with the meningitis? It is one of the important area from where the MCQs, so many MCQs questions come, okay? So two common organisms that cause the meningitis is Neisseria meningitidis and Streptococcus pneumoniae. It occurs in all age group. Okay. If someone asks you what are the common causative agent, then you should not forget about these two causative agents. It's very important cause for the meningitis. Third one is Listeria monocytogenes. It is the organism which causes the meningitis, especially in immunocompromised individuals like elderly adults, neonates, and pregnancy. So if the pregnant patient comes to me with the feature of meningitis, then I need to think about the Listeria monocytogenes as one of the etiological agent for that meningitis. Similarly, if there is a neurosurgical intervention, then one possibility is coagulase negative staph aureus. And gram-negative bacilli is more common in neonate and elderly, and S. influenza in the adult. But always remember about Listeria meningitis and Staphylococcus pneumoniae when you are dealing a case with meningitis. The pathogenesis of the meningitis is quite complicated, but I'll try to make it simple. And this is just basically for the MBBS student. So in a meningitis, the subarachnoid space is invaded by the meningeal pathogens like Listeria meningitis and the Staphylococcus pneumoniae. If there is a concomitant pneumonia, which is caused by Staphylococcus pneumoniae, then that Staphylococcus pneumoniae can travel and can invade the subarachnoid space. So when it reaches to the subarachnoid space, then definitely there is the fight between this organism and our body, our immune system. That's why that there is the release of the bacterial cell component in the subarachnoid space. It causes three things. One is when there is the inflammation going on, then it causes the altered blood-brain barrier permeability, because of which there is the vasogenic edema. There is the entry of the fluid from the blood circulation into the brain parenchyma that causes the vasogenic edema. Second is because of the inflammations and the leukocyte travel to that area, the cerebral capillaries, endothelial cells are like attached by the leukocytes, which cause the obstructive edema because this capillary can be blocked by the leukocytes. Similarly, there is the release of the excitatory amino acids, which can cause cytotoxic edema. Overall, the net result will be because of this vasogenic edema, obstructive edema, and cytotoxic edema, there will be the raised intracranial pressure. And if untreated, then the patient can go into the coma and they can die because of this condition. So here, when you are analyzing this pathogenesis, so it is the release of bacterial cell component. So even if you use the antibiotics, then without any anti-inflammatory agent, then your patient can deteriorate because of the release of the bacterial cell wall component. So we usually give the steroid prior to the use of antibiotics in a patient with meningitis. And ultimate result is the raised ICT is one of the important complications of the meningitis. The cause of which is it may be the vasogenic or obstructive or cytotoxic edema. Okay, and that's why we need to prevent this thing. So what are the typical clinical feature of the meningitis? In our clinical practice, when the fever is the important clinical feature of the meningitis. Second is headache and the neck stiffness. These are the triad for the meningitis: fever, headache, and neck stiffness. This fever, headache, and the neck stiffness. So the typical pattern of the fever in a patient with meningitis is there will be high grade fever, 104, 105, and usually do not respond with the usual antipyretic agent. And there is a neck stiffness because there is inflammation in the subarachnoid space, and as you know, there's when the subarachnoid space extension occur even at the level of spinal cord. And because of their inflammation, like nerve roots get irritated, and because of that, there is a stiffness in the neck muscles. Similarly, because of the raised ICT and the stimulation of the different pain sensitive fibers deal with the headache. This is one of the severe headache occurs in meningitis. Sometimes there can be the altered mental status and there can be seizure episodes in a patient with meningitis, but commonly what you get in the initial days, we get patient with fever and headache and sometimes neck stiffness. And like when we are not able to detect them early, then when they become complicated, then they will have the history of the altered mental status and the seizure. Okay. Then so many persons have the like infection by these organisms, but why only the few people develop the meningitis? Okay. So that's why when someone develops the meningitis, then you should not be relaxed. You should always ask yourself why this patient has meningitis. That's why you need to elicit the history regarding the immunocompromised status. When I was doing junior residency, there was a young adult with meningitis. Then on working up, we found that patient was a patient with the HIV, or retropositive status. Because of that immunocompromised status, that patient was predisposed to have meningitis. Similarly, one of the common route for the meningeal infection is the ear. That's why you need to ask about the ear discharge, like when there is a chronic suppurative otitis media, especially atypoenteral variant, then the infection can be established from the ear to the meninges. Third one is body rashes, because in one meningitis, especially meningitis caused by the Neisseria meningitis, there is also like presence of the body rashes. And when there is a body rashes and the feature of meningitis, you have to always think of Neisseria meningitis because it is highly infectious state. You should be always aware of that conditions. Similarly, history of head surgery and the head trauma, you should always ask, okay? In the physical examination, other than like assessing the vitals of the patient and doing other systematic examination, these are the four important examination finding that we'll get. One is neck rigidity. When you try to flex the neck, then there will be the neck rigidity. Similarly, there will be cornic signs will be positive and Brodzinski sign will be positive, but it's not for the all patient with meningitis. And then your head draw test will be positive. I mean that when you just move the head from the side by side, then there will increase in headache. This is head draw test, and you can do this easily in the emergency area. So this is what I'm trying to show you with the cornic sign. In the cornic sign, you have to use your two hand, one hand just behind the heel of the patient, okay? Heel of the patient. And another hand not here, okay? This hand should be here. This hand should be here. This hand should be here. You have to feel the tone of the hamstring, okay? Because there will be the hamstring spasm, okay? And your teacher will ask you, please demonstrate the cornic signs. What you have to do, you have to first flex the hip at 90 degree and knee at the 90 degree. Then you go on extending this. If there is the spasm hamstring within 135 degree, that is 90 plus 45 degree, if there is a spasm, then it's the cornic sign is positive. Like one hand you are just extending, and another hand you are feeling the spasm. But if you get the spasm within 135 degree, then the cornic sign is positive. Similarly, you can do the Brodzinski neck sign, where we have to flex the neck, and on flexing the neck, there is a flexion of the hip and knee, and this is called the Brodzinski sign. So these are the basic meningeal sign that we all have to assess when you are assessing the suspected case of meningitis. This is a rash of meningococcemia. When you see this type of purpuric rashes, then you have to always think of meningococcemia, dear. Now we have to investigate the basic investigation for the meningitis is to do the lumbar puncture. But when you are planning for the lumbar puncture, as we have already discussed regarding the lumbar puncture, you have to always rule out the raised ICT and any space occupying lesion. Okay. So after doing the lumbar puncture, we discuss everything about CSF. The appearance of the fluid will be clear. Opening pressure is 10 to 12 centimeter of water, or 10 to 12 millimeter of water. Sorry, 100 to 120 millimeter of water. WBC count up to 5 is normal, and all are lymphocytes. And glucose is usually more than 60% of the serum glucose. And protein is between 20 to 40 mg per deciliter. So these are the normal CSF finding This is how we do the lumbar puncture, and we all have discussed about the lumbar puncture in our last lecture. You can go through that video for the lumbar puncture. So how we can differentiate the bacterial from viral and the tubercular or fungal? Especially leukocyte count wise, the is highly limited in bacterial, slightly limited in viral, okay, slightly limited in viral. And in case of bacterial, the predominant cell is neutrophil, whereas in viral and other like fungal or tubercular, the predominant cell is lymphocytes. And the protein is markedly elevated in bacterial and slightly increased in viral and tubercular. And glucose is usually normal in viral, whereas it is decreased in bacterial, fungal, and tubercular. And okay, so basically, the counts are highly elevated in bacterial, and proteins are high, and glucose is low in case of bacterial, whereas in viral, count is slightly increased, and like there is a predominantly lymphocyte predominant counts, and the glucose is normal, and protein is slightly increased only. This is how we can differentiate between bacterial and viral meningitis and tubercular meningitis. It is must. We have to differentiate because the treatment of bacterial is different from viral and tubercular. So in one disease, we have to give the antibiotics, and another, we have to give the antiviral, and the other, anti-tubercular. That's why we need to differentiate. Sometimes we may have to do the CT scan, like if the GCS, if there is a low GCS, usually less than 8, if patient has seizure episodes, if patient has focal neurological deficit, if patient is immunocompromised, okay? In this scenario, even in a suspected case of meningitis, then we have to CT scan head, and this is a typical CT head. We saw the hydrocephalus, one of the deadliest complication of the meningitis. So empirically, antibiotic, antimicrobial therapy, basically after other than the supportive care, when you are caring the we'll discuss about the supportive care later on. But antibiotic wise, the very simple, like especially in the adult, we give the vancomycin, is the glycopeptide, and plus third generation cephalosporin empirically. If it is more than 50 years, then we have to add ampicillin beside the vancomycin and third generation cephalosporin. Because why ampicillin? Because ampicillin we have to give to cover the Listeria monocytogenes, because vanco and cephalosporin is not going to cover the Listeria monocytogenes. So why, what do? We just give vancomycin and third generation cephalosporin, especially ceftriaxone. This is how we treat a patient with meningitis. Don't forget this combination. And if there is a case of meningococcal meningitis, like if you see the rash and meningitis, then definitely please take this type of prophylaxis. We usually take the azithromycin 500 and the 6 single dose to all the patients who are exposed to the meningococcal, like the patient with meningococcal meningitis. Rifampicin, azithromycin, ceftriaxone are the prophylactic drug which you can give. This can be one of the MCQ questions. Regarding the steroid use, so basically we use the dexamethasone because it has the high glucocorticoid activity. Dose is 0.5 MCQID dose for 3 to 5 days. But we have to give this steroid 20 minutes prior to antibiotics. If antibiotic has already been used, then there is no use of this type of steroid. Okay, and what is the good part of the steroid is that it can decrease the inflammation, it decrease the CSF resistance, and stabilize the blood-brain barrier. Okay, and the bad part of the steroid is it can injure the hippocampus and can cause the reduced learning capacity. Okay, so use dexamethasone prior to using the antibiotics, at least 20 minutes prior to using the antibiotics. So other causative agents that can cause meningitis are Mycobacterium tuberculosis. We should never forget this agent because tuberculosis meningitis is quite common in these settings, and which can cause different focal neurological deficit. And similarly, herpes simplex virus is one of the important cause for the meningococcalitis. Okay. So in the summary, meningitis is a medical emergency which you have to diagnose early and treat early. And mortality approaches up to 100% if untreated, and CBC, two set of blood cultures, CSF analysis, and CT scan are the test. For the antibiotics, we have to give the antibiotic the proper timing and for the proper durations. Okay, at least we give for nisiramine, that is, we can use for the 7 to 7 days, and streptococcus pneumonia for 14 days, and listeria for 21 days. These are the durations. Other than the antibiotics, definitely we should never forget about the supportive cures, like giving paracetamols, then IV fluids. Okay, and some, if there is raised ICT, then you have to manage raised ICT by giving the mannitol like that. Okay. We all have to think, but discussing everything is not a scope for this class. If you have any comment, then you can write in a comment section. And thank you so much for your kind attention. Okay.